Roy's good. Good evening and welcome to the February 5th regularly scheduled meeting, thank you, of your Board of Commissioners. Tonight we've got Pastor Jacob Harris of Enriching Grace Church in Eden will be giving the invocation. Come on up. And then that will be followed by the Pledge of Allegiance by Macon Teague. So if you are able to stand, please stand for the invocation and continue standing.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, I thank you for this day. I thank you for the opportunity to be here, Father, in Rockingham County, and the opportunity that it provides. And I just ask, as this meeting commences today, Father, that this invocation does exactly that. It invokes your guidance through it all, that you watch over each and every person that speaks today, all the decisions that are made, Father, and we know that you love each person in here dearly. And we're so thankful for the love that you give and who you are. And just ask that this love be shown today, Father. Give strength, give discernment, give guidance, and we won't fail to give you the honor and praise for everything you do. In Jesus' holy, precious name, amen.
Thank you. Please remain standing. Lance, if you would, let Mr. Teague have the handheld mic. Come on up, Mr. Teague. This is Macon Teague. He's 7 years old. He attends Monroton Elementary School. Thank you for being here tonight, Mr. Teague. Everyone face the flag and render the appropriate response. Thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Great job. We appreciate you being here tonight. With that, the next item is the approval of our agenda tonight. We do have an amendment, it looks like, and this time I'll accept a motion with that amendment. Commissioner Berger?
Yes, I'd make a motion to approve the agenda with the addition under the consent agenda of item 6F, approve the appointment of Jonathan Wise to the Airport Authority Advisory Board, whose term will begin 2/5/24, expire 2/4/27.
We have a motion. Is there a second?
There is a second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. We do have an agenda set. Next, we have a resolution by our county manager, Mr. Metzler.
Yes, sir. I've got a resolution for the Reidsville High School Rams football team for their 23rd North Carolina HSAA State 2 Championship in 2023. And I will read the resolution. I will forego reading the names tonight since they're not here, and they're some of them quite hard to pronounce. So anyway, I will just end that part with saying the players and the coaches and the staff and the managers and all that. Whereas the Reidsville High School Rams football team played the Clinton High School Dark Horses at Carter-Finley Stadium in Raleigh on December the 9th and won by a score of 28-18 to capture the 2023 North Carolina High School Athletic Association State 2A Football Championship after achieving a remarkable winning season with 15 wins and one loss. And whereas this football season signifies the first year of the head coach, Eric Teague, after working for 11 years as one of many assistant coaches to his father, Jimmy Teague, playing for the Rams in the 2002 through 2005 football seasons and then at Methodist College. And whereas this championship game represents the Reidsville Rams' 30th appearance since 1930 in the NCHSAA State Championship title football game and the 23rd win in the history of Reidsville football, with no other school having won more NCHSAA football titles. And whereas the accomplishments of the 2023 Reidsville High School Rams football team can be attributed to their individual talents, the players' determination to bring home a win by working together as a team, and the depth of their coaches' experience. And whereas the 2023 Reidsville High School Rams football team throughout this successful season exhibited the skills and resolve necessary to win a national state football championship, fulfilling their motto of this year of state title number 23 in 2023. Now, therefore, the Rockingham County Board of Commissioners hereby congratulates the 2023 Reidsville High School Rams football team for its exceptional season and expresses appreciation for its accomplishments in bringing the SAA 2A State Football Championship to the city of Reidsville and to the county of Rockingham, and in particular congratulates each of the following players, coaches, trainers, and individuals for his or her personal contribution. And again, those names are on here, and if any of the commissioners like to read those, otherwise I'll forego naming the names and the coaches and the trainers and all that good stuff. So, Mr. Chair, if you would want to present this to the coach and his representatives.
Yeah.
You got to come up here.
Yeah,
you
created
this.
All right,
here's
your wife.
Mm-hmm, Jimmy.
He ought to come up. I will do it. She is not feeling well, so hold on to me.
You got yours?
I got mine. I think. Yep. Double chins go away. Are you going to get your dad up there, family?
Yeah, come on.
Come on. You got to be in the picture. Yeah, you got to be in it. Can you take a picture with your phone, too?
Sure.
Okay. I'll get yours first. Smile going. I don't see the end of crimes. That's good. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Charlie. And continuing with our recognitions, I'd like to, number one, well, I see Trey Wright in the back. He's got a new baby. Congratulations to you. And but I'd also like to thank Commissioner Richardson. Just with a couple of weeks ago, he got appointed to the statewide VIA board. In addition to being a regional board member, he's on the state board for VIA, our LME-MCO. So, Commissioner Richardson, thank you for all you do for this community. We appreciate you.
Thank you, sir.
All right, with that, the next item is our consent agenda. We'd accept a motion at this time.
Make a motion to approve.
Do we have a second? All right, we have a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All right, motion carries. Thank you. All right, next item. Looks like that's going to be public comment. We do have two folks signed up to speak tonight. We've got Neil Jakes, and with that, we've got Lance, who's going to read our guidelines tonight, and then you can make your way to the podium. Lance?
Yes, sir. The public comment period shall be for the purpose to allow members of the public to present any matter pertaining to county business or items on the Board of Commissioners' agendas. Remarks shall be addressed directly to the Board of Commissioners and not to staff, the audience or media. The chairperson did just open up the public comment period. Any speaker who wishes to speak shall approach the podium and not speak from his or her seat. Each speaker shall clearly state his or her name and physical address when he or she approaches the podium. I also went out football. Sorry about that. You should be allotted 3 minutes allowed to yield their time on a specific topic by utilizing one more attendee's time. This would allow no more than 6 minutes. The total amount of time allotted for the public comment period is up to 30 minutes. Your time will be displayed on the monitor in front of you. The clock will start with 3 minutes and less yielded time to 6 minutes. You will hear a beep at 1 minute to alert you to wrap up your comments. If you already yield time or time is yielded to you, then please let the chairman know in advance. Speakers will not be allowed to campaign for public office, promote private business ventures, or use language of a personal nature which insults or demeans any person or which, when directed at a public official, is not related to his or her official duties. The Board of Commissioners may accept written comments in lieu of oral statements. Written statements can be delivered to the County Manager's Office. Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. With that, Mr. Jakes, give us your name and address, and then you'll have 3 minutes.
My name is Neil Jakes. My address is 260 Chinquapin Trail in Reidsville. Come here to say thank you. Thank you to the for the opportunity to speak to the county commissioners on our annual countywide food drive. This is year number 14 of the drive. From humble beginnings, we've grown thanks to the generosity of the people of Rockingham County and the overwhelming enthusiasm and drive from this lady right here. In 2023, we collected 56,135 pounds of food, cleaning supplies, and paper products. Our goal for 2024 is 60,000 pounds. In addition to that, we had $1,185 in cash donations, which we're already close to matching so far this year, and in-kind donations of about $250. Our goal is to have boxes in 250 locations. This includes stores, churches, manufacturing companies, and county and city government offices. And thanks to all of those in county offices. This year, we have 10 boxes placed in various places throughout the county offices. About half of them are in this building, and I'm told by Rebecca they're in high traffic areas for employees, break rooms, and so forth. So feel free when you have your coffee to maybe throw in some applesauce for us. In addition to that, there are boxes in the fire marshal's office, the 911, registry of deeds, board of elections, and family services. So they're all about in the county offices, and we thank you very much. We thank the fire marshal, Melissa Joyce, and all the fire chiefs that the stations are serving as pickup locations, and we appreciate that. And Ms. Joyce tells me that she's looking to do something in the office there that hopefully can inspire some of the people that work there in the offices. Libraries will also be collecting throughout the county, and Ann is working with Rhonda Hooker to get those boxes in there. We have some brochures that, would you mind, Curtis, handing out those brochures? And that'll tell you about the various charities that we help. Each of these organizations works selflessly to assist those in need, and donations are distributed by those agencies, and in many cases, those agencies provide other services to help people in need. I know these agencies, and I can vouch for their integrity. When you see our boxes at a church, a store, please be generous and encourage others. And if you happen to drive by one of our signs and you're with somebody, say, that's a good group.
Thank you, Mr. Jakes.
Thank you.
Next, we have Ann Fish.
I wasn't going to say anything. That's rarity. I am astounded at having started this 14 years ago.
Give me your address.
Oh, I'm sorry. Ann Fish, 331 Wilshire Drive, Eden. Okay. We started this 14 years ago. It was going to be a one-year deal. And look where we are today. And you guys, I think, have been with us every year. The governmental center here has helped us just about every year. And we got a lot of support from the community. We have more people than ever needing food this year. We have they say that we have had calls for not only food, but one family called and wanted some wood for their stove because that was the only way they could heat their house. They had no electricity because they couldn't afford it. So one of the food pantries got them some wood for their home. So we got some dire needs in Rockingham County, and this food goes a long way. It doesn't last long when we get it in, but it goes a long way. One can of food can feed a child one meal. And I'm sure your children eat more in one meal than one can of food, but a lot of these kids, that's all they have for a meal. And it's very rewarding to be able to help all these people. And again, we thank all of you for all of your support all these years. And we need food, folks, so when you pass one of these boxes, just throw some in. We appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Fish. Thank you guys for being here tonight. There are no more folks signed up tonight, so this will conclude our public comment period. And next, we'll have our Register of Deeds, Mr. Benjamin Curtis, if you'll make your way to the podium. Please provide us an update on your office.
Benjamin Curtis, Rockingham County Register of Deeds, 420 Greenway Drive, Eden, North Carolina. As you guys know, I send an email at the beginning of every month letting you know how the previous month had done or performed. I think it's important to know how our office is performing because that kind of lets you know how healthy the county's economy is. And now that you're starting to do your budget work and plan for any major projects coming along, I just wanted to give you an update on how we're doing so far this year. As you know, that 2021 and 2022 were two of the highest grossing years that I have record of. The county switched systems about 2008, and that's about as far back as I can go. But we have almost doubled the amount of revenue coming in the last 7 years. Last year, we had a little bit of a dip of about $40,000, but I think we're going to be able to maintain a positive cash flow for the county as we have the last 7 years. Even in the year of COVID 2020, we had a large profit margin and brought in over $700,000, which was not something that used to happen. Part of the success that we're having is in 2023, we assisted more citizens with the passport program than we ever have. We assisted with over 1,000 brand new passport applications. That's the first time we eclipsed that number. And we assisted another 244 with renewals, so that was 1,200 citizens that we assisted. And to this point, we've generated over $225,000 through passport services. The notary services has brought in close to $9,000. Between those two programs, that is responsible for 20.3% of our profit margin. Those two programs are bringing in almost, are bringing in a fifth of our profit. And I appreciate the support that the county manager and the county commissioners have put behind that program. To this point, we have no new large projects going. We were continuing to put the old deed records into the DBS binders. They are water and fire resistant. They are the highest, this is the most protection we can put those records in with modern technology. That project does have an end game. We have 385 books. We're about halfway through. Another 4 or 5 years will be done, and then we'll switch over to the mayor's license. The fees for that come from the Automation and Preservation Fund. As you know, those are dedicated funds for that project, so it's not costing the taxpayers anything to get that done. And at this time, I'd like to ask if you have any questions for myself.
You mentioned the passport program. When did that start?
Our first day of active passports was June 12th, 2017. I first got into office in December of 16, contacted the county manager on January 4th of 2017. After having gone to Guilford County Register's office to get my own passport, I knew it was a program that we had the staffing personnel to implement. And so 29 days after being in office was when I first indicated to the county manager we wanted to do this. And you guys, the board at the time, was supportive. And we went live in June of 2017. It took some time to get the United States State Department to approve our office and to get supplies in. I am one of the two passport agents. We had to attend training in Raleigh. It's a two-day training, and you know, so we've been up and running since June of 2017.
You also mentioned the notary program. When did that start, or you know, providing notary services?
I believe that was around April or May of 2017. At the time, when I was preparing to take office, I was reading the Registered Deeds Guidebook, and on page 16, it said that the Registered Deeds was the head notary for the county. And when I realized the office was not already providing notary service, that was something that, you know, we're in the courthouse. People need to get things notarized. I don't know why we weren't doing that before. To this point, since 2017, we've only had to have one staff member go to court and testify, and it's on the second floor, so that was not a disruption at all.
Well, being in the courthouse, I know you just mentioned that. That was often an excuse that was provided as far as not providing that service prior to your taking office. So certainly appreciate you providing both of those services to the citizens.
Thank you.
Anyone else have questions?
Yeah.
Commissioner Powell?
Mr. Curtis, since you've taken office, how much profit have you made for the county? Do you know, Rob Tupia?
I actually emailed the county manager about two weeks ago, to have finance put those numbers together. I didn't want anybody to think I was skewing numbers, so the numbers directly from the county manager's office would indicate that we have brought in $1,131,607.91 in profit since taking office.
Mr. Metzler, I believe that prior to taking office, the county was supplementing that particular office, were we not? Curtis taking office. Mr. Curtis, I'd like to thank you for saving the taxpayers' money, not only saving them money, but making them money. Thank you for the job you're doing.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
And I, as far as your budgeting, how often are you able to give money back other than the profits to the county government?
Well, at the end of my first year, we returned money, and a county manager called me and asked him if everything was okay. Said that had never happened before. You know, he just wanted to make sure I wasn't making a mistake, and I assured him I wasn't. Any money that is unspent and unneeded is returned, and it always has been, and we've returned money for 7 years now.
Well, I certainly commend you on your budgeting practices, and I've seen evidence of a former commissioner also commending you of those practices. So thank you.
Any other questions? Comments?
What's your next motion? I want to see what your next project is.
We are always...
It's a joke.
Yeah, well, no. I assure you we are always looking for ways to increase the level of services we can offer to the citizens. Being located in the courthouse, we have a lot of foot traffic, and right now we have staffing levels right at what we need to provide the services. We're so busy with passports that, you know, Susan is amazing with that department. She is the first up to do passports. When she's off or we get busy, I'm the other passport agent, and we have been rolling.
Well, you said something that I think is real appropriate, where you said it was your job to provide the best service you could to the citizens of the county, and I feel like all our staff does that, Mr. Manager.
Thank you. Any other comments, questions? Mr. Curtis, thank you for being here tonight. We appreciate your update. We appreciate your service to the taxpayer in this community. Thank you.
Thank you, and I appreciate what you gentlemen do for the county.
Next item on our list, Ronnie Tate, Director of Engineering with Bill Lester with LKC.
Good evening, gentlemen. I've got one item tonight for your consideration, and it's for board approval of the attached utility project list. There are 7 projects on there. The estimated cost for all of these projects together total $52,913,500, the funding for which is coming out of $54,550,000 allocated to Rockingham County by the North Carolina General Assembly and approved in fiscal year 23-24 state budget. These projects are a continuation of utility projects that the county started in 2017, our newest ones, and on Highway 158 and 220. And if you'll allow me, we've got sort of a two-part presentation tonight. I wanted to speak a little bit about the history of utility system in the county, and Bill's going to provide the updates on the project list. So the county's water and sewer utility systems actually got installed probably in the late 90s, early 2000s, mid-2000s. And along, they sat for years with limited customer use, but in 2015, we began discussions looking at increasing water services in the county. And so the phase one for that water project was on 158, and that was an extension to Price Mill Road on 158. And I know it probably doesn't mean a lot to the people listening, but phase two in 2019 was an extension on NC65 and Price Mill. And the significance of that, those two extensions were that it provided the county with an interconnect at Price Mill and 158 and redundancy backup to both water systems, which is very important. I don't know, Bill could probably tell more, but there's probably not a lot of rural counties that have a redundant backup, and we do at that location. And the third phase of the water project that began in 2019 was the secondary supply from the town of Mayodan to connect to our system for the 220 system. So we not only can get water from the town of Madison, but also from the town of Mayodan. So as you can see, the early parts of these extensions were for water. And what came after that was a lot of interest in growth on the southwestern side of the county from developers calling our office, Economic Development Office, and Planning and Zoning, asking about building subdivisions on 220 and the availability of utilities out there. And it was early on in 2015 and in that area where we started to realize we didn't have sufficient capacity on 220 to meet the needs for these developments. And so we started shifting our focus, utility focus, to providing sewer capacity out there. And so in September of 2017, we had a board meeting. I was here and I presented to ask for board approval to talk with the towns of Madison and Mayodan to increase our utility capacity. The board at the time approved that unanimously. This is the first step in this process. As you can see, it's a long process, but that was the first step. And so with that approval, we entered into an MOU with the towns of Madison and Mayodan for increased sewer capacity. We had further meetings along the way. In April of 21, the board approved a contract with LKC to prepare the design and permitting for the sewer system on 220. And the board was updated also in November of 22 on the status of that and other status of other projects. And so that brings us to where we are tonight. You can see we're moving along with those utility projects on 220, but we're able to get additional funding from the state this year. There's seven projects like for Bill to discuss with you and ask for your approval moving forward with those. And so if there's not any questions, I'll get Bill up here. If you have any, I'll be glad to answer those.
Can we hold them until after Bill does?
We can. Okay. We'll probably hold questions and get
sure.
with you later.
Okay. And this is Bill Lester with LKC Engineering. He's our water and sewer design engineer.
Thank you, Ronnie, Chair and Board. I'll go through these. A lot of these projects were somewhat described in the legislative funding, but I wanted to go through them now, but we'll be presenting them to the funding agencies and asking for their final approval so that they'll release the funds for you to begin the work. The first one, I think you've got a copy of this. I'll go down and we can answer detailed questions as needed, is US 220 capacity building for the wastewater, mostly. Water is needed, as Ronnie talked about. We've done a lot with the water system, but there'll be a few things needed. That's $9.5 million. That one might be one that'll kind of stick out, what kind of things might be there. There's a lot of things to make this system, especially the interconnectivity we have, pressure zone valves, SCADA and controls. There's some economic development needs in that, water and sewer. There's some water supply things anticipated, whether it's finished water or raw water, that work within the systems that will be feeding this to you. And as well, we're well underway with some wastewater treatment upgrades, and some of that may be related to that. The second one is US 229, US Highway 29 water main extension. That's for some potential growth there on 29, and that's $20.5 million. The Madison sewer extension is some economic development for the county at $3.9 million. The supplemental water supply, we've looked at a couple of options to do that, but that, what that is to do is to bring you the full amount of contract water from the town of Madison. It's probably going to end up being something like increased line sizes in areas where it's hard for them to pull it to the booster pumps that feed your system. Water main replacement on US 220, just above Hogan's Creek. You may have heard Ronnie present over the years. There's been some kind of catastrophic problems. That line has settled down to some bedrock areas and cracked and had some problems where it literally stops service, you know, once the tanks are depleted. So this would be to go back in, get some ductile iron in those areas and prevent that. The interconnectivity does help that with some abilities for some emergency pumps if you had to bring it back. But this would continue to have those feed from both directions at all times. Getting down to the last two, one of them is miscellaneous booster pump upgrades. You have negotiated through the MOU and the interlocal agreements more supply from the towns of Mayodan and Madison. This will allow your existing booster pumps to be upgraded to be able to transfer that supply down along south along US 220 to get it to some of the growth areas of where those developments have been approved. And the last one, the booster pump station and chlorination at US 158 at $3.6 million. Ronnie talked about that interconnectivity, and a lot of people are actually pretty wise. They hear that there's different chlorine feeds at Madison and Mayodan versus Reidsville. Well, we have that interconnectivity, and we can feed as long as we are paying attention to it, opening valves and moving it. But if you ever needed that to be a little more regular, we would need to be able to chlorinate the water. It's kind of an odd word. I don't think I made that up. But what it is take free chlorine water, add ammonia to it to make it a chloramine feed, just like Reidsville does. So that project could have some changes and look at it differently as we move forward, but that's what that would do. And that would make complete and free interconnectivity between those two systems, which is a big deal. These are fairly long extensions out of the point of supply from Madison and Mayodan, one direction, and from Reidsville. So as these flows get up, you know, the developments that Ronnie was mentioning, you know, you're already looking at growth that'll go up to 750,000 gallons a day. You're going to realize that you want that ability to move water between and not just depend on what's in the tank if there's a problem along the way that you have to valve things off and correct them. So it's going to become more and more important. But that's a quick summary. I hope not too quick, but I'll be glad to answer any questions.
Questions?
I got one.
Commissioner Richardson?
Yeah, I think you can answer this quickly. I believe we put an agitator in the farthest south tank on the system. How does that relate to this chlorination process? Chlorinization, ammonization?
Okay, so that's in the 220. Well, I think you now have them in almost every tank.
We do.
You've put the mixing systems in every tank now. What it does is it helps maintain the chlorine. It helps the water maintain its quality. That's a great system to have. And in the past, you know, the usage hasn't been to the numbers I just mentioned. So with low usage, it's good to do everything you can to keep the water quality up. And that's what those mixing systems have done and will continue to do. Even when the flow, you know, does increase, those will still be a bonus to the system. And you have them in all tanks now. And the chloramination is actually a different...
basically means less water down the side ditch, right?
That's exactly what it means. As we get a higher usage, we're going to flush the system less. But flushing is part of any normal maintenance. It'll just be less of it.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Powell?
Ronnie, please.
Probably ought to get it from Bill.
Because I want to switch gears. I know we were talking about this 220 area, and earlier we talked about this, but, you know, we've got some sewer upgrades going along 220 now. Mm-hmm. And we were talking about back in the early 90s, or late 90s, early 2000s, that we voted, or the board voted, to put those lines up. We currently have sewer lines in the ground on 220. Is that correct?
Yes, sir, that is correct. It is a combination of gravity and force main on 220. Right.
And so when we put those in, we thought that that would be just for industrial use. Is that correct?
Yes, sir, that is correct.
That's the reason those lines probably were sized a little smaller. Is that correct? Bill?
Mostly correct.
High level.
In the beginning, the very, very first phase, we'll call it phase 1A, you had the new school at Huntsville, and you wanted to promote that economic development growth. You also had a very limited capacity that Madison was able to receive, because most of the capacity on paper had been given away. So you built to that capacity and what you thought you had at the time. And obviously, recently, that changed a little bit.
And so one of the reasons it changed, at some point in time, we began to get calls about housing developments, and we realized that we were going to be putting residential customers on these same lines. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. That's absolutely correct.
And so in order to do that, back in 2000, as early as 2015, the county began to start upgrading some of our pumps and different things that had to be upgraded, looking towards increasing the capacity of that sewer line along the 220 corridor. Is that correct?
At that time, it was mostly water, but there were probably some additional sewer upgrades. They were minor at the time, but the major upgrades are happening now.
Yeah. When did those major upgrades come to light in front of the board? When did the board vote on, do you remember?
It was in 2017, because it was the MOU with the towns. It does us no good to have increased piping or any of that if the towns would not grant us the capacity. And so we have that MOU. The board voted for us to approach the towns and discuss an MOU. We got that approved, and that was the first brick in this process moving forward.
And I believe the information that I've got, that would have been about November the 20th, 2017.
That sounds correct. Yes, sir.
On that date, at the end of the meeting, Commissioner Travis, who was on the board then, made a motion. Commissioner Pirtle seconded. The vote was unanimous to do that, was it not?
That's correct from the minutes, yes, sir.
So from that time until now, it's taken quite a while just to get permits and various other things that have to be gotten.
Yes.
And then the money was approved in 2021, I believe, to go ahead and proceed with this project. Is that correct?
I think that is correct, yes.
And so the reason that we're doing that today is now is because we had to increase the capacity for the sewer because of the additional growth in residential construction on the south side of Madison, is that correct?
Yes, sir. The original capacity was roughly 250 to 300,000 gallons a day. There's force main under the river there at Madison, and that's the maximum that will go through that. With what we're putting in now, we increase capacity to 1.2 million gallons per day.
Now, so in effect, what will happen now is there will be two sewer lines in 220, right?
Yes, sir.
We'll continue to use the old one, but with the new one, that increases the capacity. Is that correct?
Yes, we expect some point in the near future where we will switch over to the new system. The old system will not handle the capacity given the amount of residential construction we're seeing out there.
Thank you so much.
Welcome.
Any other questions? Any other questions? Gentlemen, thank you. And now we need approval on this project list, so that's what you're asking us for tonight. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. That is correct.
So, gentlemen, at this time, I'll ask for a motion to either approve or deny this project.
Motion made.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? None heard. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed. Motion carries. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Lester. All right, number 10, Ms. Lisa Ellington, Rockingham County Recovers. Thank you for being here tonight. We appreciate you.
Yes, sir. Good evening, commissioners, and I appreciate your time and attention to this. I believe you were provided some information in the packet that you received in regard to a request for qualifications. We had a template that we used to develop this request for qualifications, so what you have may have the title of a different department, but that has been changed. So just note that error and apologize for that oversight. This particular RFQ is directed toward programs within our communities in Rockingham County, and the intent is to promote three different topic areas or three different strategies of the 12 strategies. The first of which is early intervention. Examples of that work may be coursework, literature, anything that would discourage opioid use. It would also be work that would identify risk factors and or consequences of opioid use and address the importance of behavioral health supports. The second piece would be recovery housing supports. Clearly, we want to increase the number of opportunities for people that are working into recovery to have transitional housing. So that would be part of that support network. Additionally, it may be that they may have some financial means, but not adequate enough to get into housing that would require deposits and that sort of thing. So funding could be made available for that type of work under recovery housing supports. And last but not least, the harm reduction strategies. Examples of that work would be coursework, literature, medication kits, et cetera, that is for community support or distribution. That would be, an example of that would be to identify common adverse risk factors of the opioid use disorders, such as poor nutrition, poor personal hygiene, spread of communicable disease, unintended death by overdose, or unplanned pregnancy, or children that have come into foster care because of the adverse risk factors of opioid use disorder. So what we're trying to do is advocate for some funding for some grassroots community programming, and we'd like to advocate for up to four awards. I would like to see, you know, our faith-based community involved. I would like to see other community programs that people have maybe great ideas of things that they would like to develop to support their programs in their community, but they just don't have the financial means to do so. So as part of Rockingham County Recoveries, that was formerly known as the Opioid Task Force, and we've renamed that to Rockingham County Recovers, but we would like to advocate for and garner your support for the approval of up to four awards in the neighborhood of about $25,000 each for those kinds of programs. Those would be subject to scoring. I think also in your packet you were provided, it's referred to, I believe it was the Rockingham County High Impact Opioid Abatement Strategy. It's a scoring matrix that's been developed. We wanted to make sure that people had adequate content that fully expressed their intent with their program, provided for a budget to support the program, and also that they were local in our communities and not outside of our community seeking funding. So at this time, I'm asking for your support for the request for qualifications for up to four awards of $25,000 each.
Thank you. Do we have any questions, gentlemen? Yeah, Commissioner Barrow.
So, Lisa, I just want to cover a couple things for the public since I serve with you on the board, and I think I may be able to just bring some clarification to a couple of points. So we are voting to approve this RFQ process tonight. And with these strategies that you're talking about, these are not local funds you're requesting. This is a request for potentially funding from the opioid settlement fund. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. 100% would be from opioid settlement funding.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Chair,
Mr. Manager.
Just to add to that is typically we don't, bless you, we don't bring the RFQ process to the commissioners, but at this time we wanted to make sure the public knows and realizes that you all are serious about addressing the opioid epidemic. So that, and also you are using opioid funds and the board has to approve the opioid funds. So we really appreciate the HHS's board and commitment for that and the opioid recovery group.
So should we approve this application process, would there be a budget amendment in an upcoming?
Yes, if we do get the grant funding, then you all would have to approve a budget amendment to transfer those opioid funds.
Okay. Any further questions, gentlemen?
Mr. Chair, I'd like to make a motion to approve.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to second that motion.
Thank you. I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you so much. We appreciate you being here tonight, Ms. Ellington.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you all.
Next item, item 11, Clyde Albright, our county attorney. Mr. Albright.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I bring before you tonight a resolution to conditionally accept the offer of 8505 Warner Road, LLC, to purchase 128.79 acres at the so-called Horse Park property in Reidsville. And should you approve this resolution, we'll place an ad in the paper for 10 days requesting any parties that are interested to provide an upset bid. And we anticipate the ad going out and in the paper on the 14th of February. And 10 days will be on the 24th, which is a Saturday. So we would bring this to you at the meeting on February 26th if there are no upset bids for final approval of the $1.1 million transaction.
We're meeting on the 19th.
February 19th. We're good. First meeting in March. Yeah, the next meeting is the 19th for us. That'd be...
I'm sorry. That would be March 18th.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. What threw us off was the newspaper only publishes once a week, and you have to have 10 days. And so the 10 days is not going to end until the 24th of February, and we'll open the bids. We've advertised sealed bids. If there are any upset bids, be presented to the manager. He'll open them up on Monday, February 26th, and then we'll announce the results at the meeting in March.
I'm sorry, Mr. Chair. Mr. Albright, is that our first meeting in March?
Yeah, it'll be March. March 4th will be the first meeting in March.
Okay, and that's when we'll take this up after the bids are opened. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion to accept the resolution.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
Some clarification really for the public. This offer of $1.1 million, we have sold other parcels off of the original Horse Park property over time, correct?
Yes, sir.
That's correct. We sold two parcels off of it.
Okay, and so this $1.1 million will actually put us in the black.
That's correct.
As far as what the county put in, what the city did as far as putting money into that original Horse Park property. Do you have those numbers tonight?
Or sorry, I don't have those.
Okay, I didn't ask you ahead of time.
But it does put both the city and the county in the black.
Okay. All right.
One last thing, Mr. Metzler, I believe that the two parcels that have been sold off of it so far would be considered by far the best parcels on this piece of land. Is that correct?
Correct.
Any further discussion? We'll call for a vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Proceed, Mr. Attorney. All right. Mr. Manager, is there any new business tonight?
No, sir.
Very good. With that, we'll go to commissioner comments, and we'll lead off with Commissioner Barrow.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have no comments tonight. Thank
you. Commissioner Richardson.
Thank you all that came and all of those listening on the computer or on the screen. Good job for Roy to get the word out there. So thank you to all that are taking the time to keep up with county business. I'm sorry Ann Fish has already left, because I want to recognize and thank Ann Fish for her continuing efforts of veteran recognition that she's done over the years. And they were interrupted by COVID, but I was pleased to serve with Ann on her committee, where we recognize the veterans of Rockingham County for several years there, and we look forward to that coming back. But that would not have occurred without the efforts of Ann Fish, so thank you very much to Ann. I'd also like to recognize a county employee named Kathy Powers. Most of you don't know her. She doesn't dwell in this building, but she directs our aging and disability program for the county. Her offices are over in Reidsville. And whether you know it or not, her efforts are all around you. Her efforts help manage the Meals on Wheels and the SCAT system and CATS and transport and general recreation and support activities for our elderly population, and also individuals that have challenges, physical challenges that need to be dealt with. And Kathy's been with us for over 10 years now, and she's been director now for about 6 years. And she's just done a remarkable job. And I just feel like sometimes the efforts of some real champions out here for our residents get ignored. And so I'm taking this opportunity for you to encourage you, if you see Kathy Powers, about her duties, to thank her for what she does for the residents of Rockingham County. That's all I have, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Berger.
Just two things. One, under the consent agenda, we did take a little bit further action for that veteran diversion program and the coordinator for the veteran diversion program. So for those who have not been made aware, we, with partnership of the district attorney and the clerk, Judge Chris Freeman, been able to get kick-started a veteran diversion program for low-level offenses that end up in the court system, nonviolent offenses, trying to keep these veterans that have served the country from, trying to keep them out of the court system as much as possible and giving them a chance for some sort of deferred prosecution. So certainly appreciate the members of this board in continuing to move that program forward. Then, you know, we oftentimes recognize or memorialize to some degree members of the community that have passed away. And being involved in local government for the last really 24 years, either with the town of Mayodan or town of Walnut Cove, or here on this board, had a lot of interaction with Mr. Rex Rouse. The Eden community lost Mr. Rouse, I believe that was Saturday morning, and Rex would serve as the auditor for just about every small town in this area. I know he did Eden, Mayodan, Madison, and just a lot of the towns in this area. Rex will certainly be missed. We certainly have offer our thoughts and prayers to the family. Those that did not know Rex, you missed a true gentleman. I know this is the year of the trail, and part of that trail is our river system. Rex was known for traversing the rivers. I believe he floated the Dan from Danbury all the way to the Sound. He loved the outdoors. He was oftentimes referred to as Rockingham County's Huckleberry Finn. And Rex was quite the gentleman, and also was honored during the UNC Duke basketball game on radio by the Tar Heel Sports Network. So Rex will certainly be missed. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Powell.
Yes, I'd like to take an opportunity to thank you for being here tonight. We always appreciate the public coming to our meeting. We try to make every effort to make as much information available to you as possible. But however, if you have questions, you can contact either any one of the commissioners or the staff here, and we can get you the answers that you seek out. It's always a pleasure to recognize our elected officials that join our meeting. Tonight we had Paula Rakestraw with the school board, Philip Butler with the Rockingham County School Board, and Kimberly McMichael with the school board. And of course, we also had Ben Curtis, the Register of Deeds. We appreciate these folks and the hard work that they do for our county, and we thank all of you for being here.
Thank you, Commissioner. Well, we heard, we didn't hear Curtis Pierce speak. He was here tonight with Ann and the other gentleman, and he's on our honor guard. They honor military who've passed in the current year. They always do that and do a great job. We appreciate the work they do with our veterans. But additionally, you heard me say something earlier regarding Commissioner Richardson, his service on the VIA board. Being on the Board of Commissioners is more than just attending a meeting twice a month. There are a lot of things that go on behind the scenes that the public never sees. And, for example, that VIA board is one of them. It's a state board. They handle mental health issues in this community. And we also, on the regional board, we also have Keith Duncan, a former commissioner, who serves on that board along with Mark. So we appreciate their service. Additionally, we heard from Lisa tonight about health and human services items. And on that board is Commissioner Barrow and Commissioner Powell. So there's an additional meeting that they attend and deal with on these other issues. Issues with our schools come up. We have Commissioner Berger and Commissioner Powell who investigate those and liaison with their school board so we can work on issues that come up there. Economic development. Again, we have Commissioner Berger and Powell work on the CED and the TDA boards to help concentrate on those. And that's just a few of the items that these commissioners work on in addition to the things you see brought up on a Monday night here in this community twice a month. So I want to thank you guys personally for all the extra work you put in to do these other items that, again, the public never sees. So I'll thank you personally for that. With that, I'll say that our next meeting is February 19th here at the Governmental Center at 6:30. And with that, I will accept a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Is there a second? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you, gentlemen.